Good morning, and welcome to everyone who is able to be with us here in the sanctuary on this glorious sunny Sunday morning, and also those who will be joining us online throughout the week, and as we understand, will be joining with us online across the country. And so welcome to everyone. Today is the last Sunday in the season of Epiphany. That's the season that focuses on the appearing, the manifestation of Jesus' presence and his public ministry. This Sunday is literally a high point scripturally, because it's on the top of a mountain as Jesus is transfigured, as he's changed, appearing in full glory and then returning to normal life with his somewhat stunned and shocked disciples. And this appears in all three of the Synoptic Gospels, and so it was a very important emphasis for the first Christians and also for us as we understand our calling from God. On this Wednesday, we are going to begin the season of Lent with an Ash Wednesday observance and communion. That will be at 7 p.m. here. And this begins our journey with Jesus toward Jerusalem and Holy Week. With this service, and also with our newly produced Lenten devotional booklet, we have copies in the back. It's also gone out on your online with your Friday email. And with this, we can reflect as we journey with our Lord toward his week of sacrifice and his Easter rising. We want to express great thanks to all who contributed to the Lenten devotional, and also to Sarah Punt, our Christian educator, who pulled all of this together for us. And speaking of Sarah, who's also our youth ministry director, our youth are going to be leading us in worship next Sunday on March the 6th, and we're very excited, and we want to come together to learn from them and to worship as they lead and to support their important presence and ministry in our congregation. And then beginning on March 13th, we're going to have a four-Sunday walk through the Apostle Paul's first letter to the church at Corinth in Greece. And this is a vital learning and worship experience for us as we begin to interact with our congregation's pastor search committee. There's an announcement in the bulletin. And as we share what it means to be the church that God has called us to be. Friends, we want to continue our prayers for Tom Bass as he continues to make progress following surgery for strength and quick recovery. And our prayers are with the family of Ann Schmidt, who died this week, only a couple of months before her 105th birthday. And we will have a gathering Next Friday, March the 4th at 1 p.m., there will be visitation beginning at noon here in the sanctuary for a service in which we can honor and remember and express our love for Anne and her witness in this congregation. We also, of course, after we've been watching the news this week, we want to join our hearts and our prayers and concern and support, as well as shock, even horror, of what is occurring for the people of Ukraine. We pray that all in this world will continue to condemn and to push against an unprovoked invasion of a sovereign, democratically led nation by an autocratic Russian state. We also pray for a world in which the leadership that emerges will, and that comes to exist everywhere, is going to be dedicated to public service, peaceful existence, and constructing a good future for all people. We have a lot of announcements. It's come to our attention that during this week, Lars Winterly is turning 13 years old. So, congratulations, Lars. 13 is a big step. And we do have a lot of concerns that we've shared this morning, but are there other announcements and other joys that we want to share today? Then, friends, let us be joined together responsibly in our call to worship. Greetings in the brightness of this hour. Let us open our hearts to the transforming power of God. We seek to let God's vision become our vision. Let us open our hearts to the special word that God has for us this day. We seek to be channels through which the Lord's grace touches our lives and the lives of others. Let us open our spirits to the revelation God has for us. We seek to be transformed so that Christ's ministry becomes our own. Let us then sing praise to God. Thank you. And thank you to those who are joining up in the choir loft to help us go through our hymns as we hum or as we read the words in the hymn book. And our council is going to be meeting on Tuesday the 8th and is going to be determining what our policy is going to be going forward. But in terms of masks, we're not singing yet. Friends, we come to worship challenged by the scriptures and by events of our world today, by people experiencing massive dislocations in their lives, and by our own expectations of ourselves. So let us confess our sins to God. Precious Lord, we come into the brightness of your glory, knowing that we have fallen short in so many ways this week. There have been times when your light showed us the path to take, but we did not take it because it looked difficult. There have been times you gave us someone to love, but we were so caught up in our own anxieties that we did not respond. There have been times you called us forward, but we lagged behind rather than respond to the challenge of discipleship. There have been times when we could have been peacemakers, but we would not be budged from our attitudes of indifference. Redeem us and transform us by the radiance of your love, that we may continually become the persons you had in mind when you created us. Amen. Let us take a few moments and open our hearts in silent prayer before God. Friends, hear these words of assurance. God raises us up to be joint heirs with Christ. As the psalmist wrote, "Whoever is wise, let them give heed to these things. Let them consider the steadfast love of the Lord." In God's steadfast love, we are forgiven and made whole. Thanks be to God.
Today is from Exodus chapter 24, verses 12 through 18. In this passage from Exodus, Moses goes up to Mount Sinai and receives the two stone tablets from God containing the Ten Commandments. The Hebrew people assumed that God was up, and therefore mountaintops, especially shrouded in cloud, were places where encounters with God were more likely to happen. Scripture says that when Moses finally came down the mountain to the Israelites, his face shone with the radiance of having encountered God. The Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me upon the mountain and wait there, and I will give you the tablets of stone with the law and their commandment, which I have written for their instruction." So Moses set out with his assistant Joshua, and Moses went up into the mountain of God. To the elders he had said, "Wait here for us until we come to you again, for Aaron and Hur are with you. Whoever has a dispute may go to them." Then Moses went up on the mountain, and the cloud covered the mountain. The glory of the Lord settled on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it for 6 days. On the seventh day, he called to Moses out of the cloud. Now the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire on the top of the mountain in the sight of the people for Israel. Moses entered the cloud and went up on the mountain. Moses was on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Friends, let us now find ourselves in an attitude of prayer in God's presence within the heart of our God. On today, loving and glorious God, we open the eyes of our hearts, the eyes of our minds, and the eyes of our faith to you, to see you, to perceive your presence in our lives, both here in this place of sanctuary and every day, every single day. In your wisdom, O God, you bring epiphanies daily into our lives. And when we have the spiritual clarity of vision, when we have the courage to embrace those epiphanies, you change us and you hold us, you restore us. For while you could stay hidden behind your glory, you sent Jesus to us. You sent him to show us your heart, your love, your will for all people. When you could have remained silent for all time, you continue to whisper your hopes to us in every moment. When you could remain on the pinnacle of our praises, you enter into the depths of our shadowed lives. You alone, O God, are holy, and yet you let your holiness touch and embrace your people. And so when we bump along over the potholes of impatience, Lord God, smooth out our lives with your wisdom. When we live in hollows of hopelessness, transfigure us with your joy. When we would wander lone valleys of grief and of death, be beside us, hold our hearts. You alone, O God, are holy. And yet you come to your people in humble and saving love. You transform everyday events into miracles of awe. You infuse joy into the emptiness of our souls. You enter into the confusion of our feeble and fearful faith, our disrupted and disrupting world. You reveal to us the morning star of hope. You alone are holy, and you let your mystery transform us. O God, you are always present, and you're always in community and communication of faith with us. You are the glory of our mountaintops and the comfort of our valleys. So we do lift before you the joys and the cares of your people. So we continue to pray for Tom Bass for strength to be well. We pray for the family of Ann Schmidt and her friends as they would celebrate her long and good life, her faithful presence as a lifelong member of this Salem Church, and her legacy that remains with family and the community of faith. O God, we especially in this week and in the weeks to come would pray for the peoples of Ukraine who find themselves utterly alone against the horrible and horrifying invasion that is senseless, brutal, and unprovoked. May all who care for peace, who care for rationality in this world, speak out and reach out beyond the moment, beyond the crisis. May we all work together for a world where such things will simply cease to be. Now, God, guide us to rise without fear, to live filled with hope and expectation, with spiritual eyes open, to call upon you in whatever ways and situations that we find ourselves, to center ourselves with the prayer of Jesus that he taught his disciples then and now to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we noted, the Transfiguration, a vital passage for the early church and for us, occurs in Matthew and Mark and Luke. This is the rendering from the 17th chapter of Matthew. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and his brother John, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And Jesus was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will make three dwellings here, one for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah. While he was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud a voice said, This is my son, the beloved. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him. When the disciples heard this, they fell to the ground and were overcome by fear. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, Get up and do not be afraid. And when they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus ordered them, Tell no one about the vision until after the Son of Man has been raised from the dead. May God bless to us this reading from the Gospel, for this is the word of the Lord. Today we're talking about epiphanies. Sometimes epiphanies come, as they should, in surprising ways. There once was a Dr. Paul Pearsall, who was with his wife attending a meeting in Rome, and their first stop was a tour of Vatican City, of course. Michelangelo's work in the Sistine Chapel had just been renovated. Dr. Pearsall and his wife waited for hours just to get a glimpse of this remarkable feat. Now, as they went in at a distance, the paintings, well, after all that waiting, just simply didn't look all that impressive. And people were chattering and they were joking about getting a paint-by-number replica of Michelangelo's work for their own ceilings at home. But when they got closer, when they got beneath the chapel ceiling, well, they were overwhelmed. The paintings just simply seemed to engulf them, and everyone became totally quiet. Their necks were aching in the effort to look straight up. Now they were seeing the paintings as Michelangelo intended for them to be seen, and the impact was unforgettable. And as they were watching, Dr. Pearsall noticed a fly crawling across the paintings. And he thought, what a shame. That fly is right up there where I would love to be, right on top of it, but he can't see it. And then Dr. Pearsall remembered reading the words of philosopher William Irwin Thompson, who wrote, We are like flies crawling across the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel. We cannot see what angels and gods lie beneath the threshold of our perception. Well, this last Sunday in the season of Epiphany traditionally has used these accounts from Matthew, Mark, and Luke of the Transfiguration because it's a season of the manifestation, the appearing of Christ, which is what Epiphany means. And, well, this is a whiz-bang manifestation, isn't it? It draws the Christian to recall that Exodus passage that Carrie read for us, when Moses was so close to God that his face was shining with radiance, even after the encounter. And no doubt, the disciples who were with Jesus, if not having a radiance showing on their faces, they certainly probably had a look of bewilderment and awe when they came down to the other disciples. And yet, these disciples did keep silence, and they told no one in those days of anything that they had seen, as Jesus commanded them. And can you really blame them? Maybe they had a fear of being ridiculed, and so they kept quiet. Or maybe they simply didn't want to say how foolishly they had responded, wanting to build a little booth for Jesus and Moses and Elijah. Or maybe rather they were touched by God to hold on to that experience until it made sense for them. Until they could step back and they could take a look at who Jesus really was in his whole ministry, the whole picture. For the disciples and for the early Christian church, this was the most important thing that they did in reflecting on Jesus' ministry. They told the stories of Jesus. They put all these different pieces together into a mosaic of faith and experience and hope and of need and of worship and of prayer. And thus Christ became for them a living presence as the Holy Spirit then spoke to them. Not because they were so close anymore to the radiance that the radiance rubs off on them, but because they embraced a critical distance. They embraced a perspective from which they could see and experience the many, many facets of God's will, the many, many opportunities of God's power to be known in their lives. They stepped back. They could see the colors and the hues of faith as a panoramic masterpiece depicting life as God would have us to live it. So, what about ourselves today? We hear the story of Moses' face and we say to ourselves, well, okay, perhaps God did give him this kind of vision, this look at God, and the radiance stayed with him for a while. And yes, Jesus may have appeared with Moses and Elijah because they were both associated with the arrival of the Messiah, but is our faith today supposed to expect and seek such epiphanies as this before we take God seriously? Well, yes and no. How's that for a definitive theological answer? Huh? I mean, Christian faith is not, nor should it be, an either or. It's not expected to be all ecstatic, over-the-top experiences, and it should not also be all formal routine tradition. It needs to be both. It needs to be an ebb and flow like a dance. We need to go to the mountaintop to be close to the mystery and majesty of God. But we also need to get back and to view the whole of living as God paints it. Now, we can't do this just by planning and design, but we can do it by experience. If we hold the expectation that God is revealed in glory in times in our lives when we are prepared and ready to look, that God will be revealed, often in ways we don't expect. And Jesus gives us a clue on how to do this. The only disciples that saw the transfiguration of Jesus, do you remember the names? Peter, James, and John. They were the ones who, quote, went with him. And we've heard this before. We've heard this. And nothing happened along the way up the mountain. There were other times where Jesus took Peter, James, and John. Do you remember? Remember when he took them with him and he said, "Stay awake while I pray"? What did they do? They fell asleep. Journeying with Jesus is not always a magical ride. But when the time came for them to behold the glory, they were there. They were there. But after that experience, they still had long miles to go with Jesus. They still misunderstood many of his teachings, or most of his teachings. They placed their needs and their egos above his calling to them. They also uncovered the frailty to abandon him. Even when we have a deep, powerful sense of God, it doesn't mean that all of our days are going to be spent on the mountaintop, in the clouds. Jesus came to show us that the God of the cosmos has actually given us a very down-to-earth faith. So the times of God's powerful presence, the epiphanies, carry us through our days of routine. And our times of routine and even our times of trial become a journey along which we travel with Christ until God's manifestation is revealed before us again and again. Some of you may know the name Dr. Elizabeth Kubler-Ross. She was famous for doing research in a famous book on death and dying. And she came across a story of an African-American woman who was on the maintenance crew at a hospital. This woman spent her day doing the routine things of her job, cleaning floors, emptying waste baskets, tidying up. But the story said that the staff of this hospital began to notice that every time she finished cleaning the room of a dying patient, that person invariably seemed happier or more content or at peace. And so Dr. Kubler-Ross interviewed this woman to find out why. The woman said that in her own life, she had known a lot of fear and a lot of tragedy as well as good times. And people helped her to know of God's love, that she had been up and down the mountain. And she said the worst time was when her 3-year-old son was ill with pneumonia, and she went to a public health clinic, and while she waited and waited, her son died in her arms. And she acknowledged that all of this could have embittered her, she said to Dr. Kubler-Ross. "You see, doctor, the dying patients are just like old acquaintances to me. So I'm not afraid to touch them, to talk with them. I'm not afraid to offer them hope." They promoted her at that hospital. She became a special counselor to the dying. And most likely, if you'd asked this lady if she had ever encountered God directly, I think she would have said she encountered God directly all the time through the love and the fellowship that she shared with those for whom she cared. Friends, in churches, we have different seasons. We have lofty services, we have special music. We have moving times of worship for the high holy times like Easter and Christmas, and we need those. We really need those because they display and they evoke the mystery and the majesty of God. But I think we can only do this if we also walk the routine days and routine Sundays the rest of the year. And I found over the years there are plenty of people. This is true both in Judaism and in Christian tradition. People who only come to worship for the special religious festivals and enjoy the pageantry. But I sometimes feel a sadness that Their hearts may be momentarily warmed, but their faces can't glow for long beyond the festive season. Because the God that they seek to run into becomes a seasonal God, the God of decorations, God of nostalgia, but not the God of daily struggles and daily questions. It's what the Christian author and pastor Bruce Larson, whom I've spoken of Bruce before, he once called it the fatal fascination with the fabulous in the church. And just as sad as the experience of making faith so routine that you never come to have an expectation of being powerfully moved, because that becomes self-fulfilling. I'm interested in seminaries, there's a field of theology that's called practical theology. I guess the rest is impractical theology? I don't know. Although seminary might not include her in that group of practical theology, I think one of the most practical theologians I ever read was named Irma Bombeck. Irma Bombeck was once asked if she had her life to live over, would she change anything? This is her answer. My answer was no, but then I thought about it and changed my answer, changed my mind. If I had my life to live over again, I would have waxed less and listened more. I would never have insisted the car windows be rolled up on a summer day because my hair had just been sprayed and teased. I would have invited friends over for dinner even if the carpet was stained and the sofa faded. I would have eaten popcorn in the good living room and worried less about the dirt when you lit the fireplace. I would have taken time to listen to my grandfather ramble about his youth. I would have burnt the pink candle sculptured like a rose before it melted while being stored. I would have sat cross-legged on the lawn with my children and never worried about grass stains. I would have cried and laughed less while watching television and more while watching real life. I would have eaten less cottage cheese and more ice cream. I would have gone to bed when I was sick instead of pretending the earth would go into a holding pattern if I weren't there for the day. I would never have bought anything just because it was practical, wouldn't show soil, and was guaranteed to last a lifetime. When my child kissed me impetuously, I never would have said, later, go now wash up for dinner. There would have been more I love yous, more I'm sorries, more I'm listening, but mostly, given another shot at life, I would seize every minute of it. Look at it, really see it, try it on, live it, exhaust it, and never give the minute back until there was nothing left of it. I guess in more traditional theological language, Irma Bombeck is simply saying what the Transfiguration means. That grace in life flows both ways, expecting the extraordinary in the common life makes for extraordinary common life. And looking for simple and abiding truths in the glorious moments provides a glow for our faces that lasts beyond that moment into the common days. One leads to the other and back again. Common life prepares us for the miraculous. Miraculous maintains our expectations in the common life for the miracles yet to appear. Now, during this week, I suppose I could have spent all of my sermon prep time delving scripturally into the Greek and asking questions of what really happened to Jesus in the Hebrew, what really happened to Moses on the mountaintops. But you know what? I think I'm pretty satisfied with the statement that something big and amazing happened, and it showed. But instead, during the week, I was reading and recalling the ministry of a minister named Reverend Bruce Main. I met Bruce years ago when he had started an astounding ministry in the inner cities, many inner cities, for children. He strengthened their educational attainment, their sense of self-worth, and their awareness of their worth in God's eyes, which made every person worthy. In the midst of communities where things were hard, opportunities were few, Bruce showed them the glory of God in common moments shared together. And that ministry is now in many urban settings, and it's even international. It's called Urban Promise. Bruce wrote a book called Spotting the Sacred, noticing God in the most unlikely places. He comments that he, like we, often think, well, you know, if I saw something truly miraculous, then I would surely have a strong faith. But then he realized, as he looks at the Gospels, that faith doesn't follow the miracle of Jesus most of the time. Read through it. Faith doesn't follow the miracles. The miraculous seems to follow acts of faith, or even acts of just being with Jesus to see what will happen. And so in his book, Bruce recalled an episode with Dr. Bryant Kirkland, who was a longtime and famous pastor of Fifth Avenue Church in New York City. He said a young seminarian was serving an internship with Dr. Bryant at Fifth Avenue. The first meeting was lunch at the University Club in Manhattan, a rather auspicious start for a young seminarian. And when lunch arrived, Dr. Kirkland looked at the young seminarian and said, "Do you mind if we pray New York style?" New York style. Well, the seminarian had no idea what this pastor was talking about, so he just nodded his head and smiled. And at this, Dr. Kirkland reached across the table and he took his hands and he looked straight into his eyes, and with his eyes wide open, Kirkland began to pray. "Lord, thanks for my young friend. Thanks for the privilege of ministering with him. May our food today be as wonderful as our newfound friendship." And the prayer didn't end there. And Kirkland began to look around the room, and he kept praying. "And Lord, the waitress over there in the corner, she looks burdened. Please ease her burden. Give her something to smile about today." And at this, the young seminarian glanced toward the corner, and there was a waitress looking somewhat burdened. "And Lord, those businessmen and women at the table next to the window, as they make decisions over lunch that could potentially impact the lives of hundreds of thousands of people, help them make decisions with kindness and compassion." And for the next 5 minutes, Dr. Kirkland just looked around the University Club, making observations and praying for people with eyes wide open. It occurs to me we often close our eyes in the presence of God, not just physically, but spiritually. Sometimes we don't see what truly miraculous things are happening or can happen every day, every day, everywhere. We conclude our worship today, as we should on Transfiguration Sunday, with a rousing hymn of praise to the glory of Christ. All hail the power of Jesus' name. But as we hear these words sung, as we hum along, as we read the words in our hymnal, I often think we do so with the expectation that God's glory in creation is meant to be viewed separately from us creatures to whom God has entrusted the creation. that the glory of the living Christ is somehow supposed to be left here in the sanctuary. So as we experience this hymn, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name, let's prepare to take it with us. Like Moses coming off the mountain from conversation with God, face aglow, let's take All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name with us. Like the disciples, Peter, James, and John, carrying the experience of the transfiguration in their hearts until it rekindled their memories, it empowered their ministry. Let's make our lives, our prayers, our acts of ministry, going forward, to all hail the power of Jesus' name. In praise of the sanctuary, and throughout the common days that open us to the epiphanies of God. Let's keep our eyes of faith open. God will appear. Amen. When Jesus' glory is revealed to us, we become transformed. We are not who we were before. Let us go now to our homes, our neighborhoods, our schools and places of work as new people whose lives glow. May we go as Christians illumined by the glory of God in Christ, renewed and radiant every single day. Amen.